Corbett Wall with DV Auction, here with your feeder flash for Thursday, September the 30th, brought to you in part by Noramycin by Norbrook. Noramycin 300 LA is an economical 300 milligram oxytetracycline that delivers the same amount of antibiotic as a 200 milligram in a lower volume dose. It's a must have in your vet shack, in your pickup, or in your saddlebag. For more information, go to norbrook.com. We're slowing harvest, and I'm not talking about your corn harvest, and we're just getting going on beans good too. They're really flying through that stuff. It's been really dry up through the Midwest, and some of those fools in Chicago may think that because it's been so dry there that's bad, because they keep tacking on to your December spot corn futures here right during harvest when it's going like gangbusters. We're ahead of the game, ahead of the five-year, ahead of the average of the last 5 years by about 3 percentage points as of the beginning of the week there, and it's rolling right along, and especially in the eastern corn belt, looking pretty good for as dry as it's been, and even in the west, you know, they're getting by. A lot of that was chopped, going to make a lot of feed. I'm not talking about the slowing of the grain harvest. I'm talking about the slowing of the harvest of cattle. And you think, well, why are your packers doing that? They're making over $1,000 a head. Well, they're just controlling the supply. And they're slowing the harvest because they know they're running into some tighter supplies of market-ready cattle, and so they can back them up just a little bit here. They're kind of taking turns, each major packer taking turns doing some cooler cleaning and things like that. Seems like they have mechanical breakdowns all the time anymore. I don't know. It's a good thing that they're not in the business of some other type of making power or something like that, or a factory that has to keep punching stuff out for the good of mankind. But they have a lot of breakdowns anymore, and they're slowing things down a little bit. They're also slowing things down because they're tired of bleeding their box beef cutout values. Your choice cutouts fell below $3, heaven forbid. You know, they're not wanting to give $2 a pound dress for cattle, but they're getting nervous because they've fallen under $3 a pound for dressed beef. But they can slow harvest there, and then they won't have quite as much product. No, they won't have quite as much product to sell, and that might set them back just for a little bit, but it'll spur up your buyers on the other end to get in and start buying product again, and they can stop bleeding on the box beef cutout values. But they're just master manipulators of the market and master managers of supplies, and that's what they're doing. They know they're going to get them all anyway, and until we get some significant packing plants built that are aside from the major four that we have right now that control almost 85% of your steer and heifer slaughter, that they can pretty much just do anything that they want, and that's what they're doing. Let's talk politics a little bit, or at least on some things we need to get past. And I tell you guys, you need to make your lawmakers aware of what's going on. We've got a big push between now and the end of the year where we've got some things that we need to get done. So it's looking like they may shut down the government, which I think we could get by with that for a while because of this $3.5 trillion infrastructure deal that you know, anyone with a brain knows that we can't pass. But the Democrats are going to try to push that through. There's a few level-headed ones in there in some states that are kind of more balanced that may put an end to that. But it's a possibility that we might have to close the government down. We did that in Obama's administration there a time or two. It wasn't the end of the world, but they're not going to increase the debt ceiling because of that $3.5 trillion infrastructure bill. So some things are just kind of on hold right now. Well, LMR, or mandatory price reporting of livestock, which you know, we use that information lots of different places. That's a law, and it has to be renewed every 5 years. Well, last year we put it off for a year because we thought we were going to get some of this legislation to balance out the trade and make it more fair. Well, we spent a whole year piddling around, and we haven't got anything done. That LMR needed to be extended by the end of September. Well, we're here, and it hasn't been done. So it looks like they could push it off maybe till the end of the year. And but we were kind of planning on using some of your mandatory price reporting information and rules and enforcement to try to push some of these minimum negotiated cash trade bills that's coming through. So, you know, it's time to shit or get off the pot. We've got to introduce those, push them through, and see if we've got enough support to get it done or not. But even the Grassley bunch has decided that 50-14 is too aggressive. You know, we can get 50 in Iowa, and that's really all they care about, because they're working about for their constituents in Iowa. They're at about 50% negotiated trade right now anyway. So we'll let them have 50% in Iowa. We'll combine that with the Cattle Market Transparency Act that Deb Fisher introduced, and we'll get something that we can pass, something that's doable, where it's at different percentages depending on what geographical area you're in, and then still each individual major plant will have to live by that. It's not just each geographical area total, but each plant will have to live up to whatever that percentage is. It'll make a big difference wherever we set it, guys. But we need to get that pushed through. You know, some of the powers that be, I know the U.S. Cattlemen's Association thinks that we can get this done. I keep up with them, and I'm in that belief too, if that's what they say. They think we can get it done. Let's get it done. We need a big push for that. If you got any pull at all with your grassroots trade association or your state trade association or some lawmakers, make a phone call to somebody. Just make a point to make a phone call to somebody and tell them we've got to get a combination bill of 50-14 and Cattle Market Transparency Act pushed through between now and the end of the year. Let's just get it done. Okay, in our truth and labeling, we've got some things done too. RCAF put out a statement there on Wednesday that said they are asking people to call in. Make a double call whenever you call in. They have introduced the mandatory country of origin labeling, which would actually rescind taking that away back in 2015. It's called the American Beef Labeling Act. You know, that would be a good one to get. If we can't get that one, let's get the one that Mike Rounds introduced here a while back called the USA Beef Act. That would tell you whether or not it is, you know, born, raised, backgrounded, fed, slaughtered, processed in the United States or not, one or the other. Mandatory country of origin labeling would list every country on the label that it could be a product of. I don't see why we couldn't get a combination of those two acts and just get something done. Let's get both those things done between now and the end of the year. Why not? NCBA is not supported either one of them. In fact, they're kind of fighting back against it, saying that, oh, well, let's just back off and water that labeling deal way back and way down, and let's not get anything done, and let's just make this minimum negotiated trade, let's just make that voluntary. Let's just make the speed limit voluntary too. You know, they tried that up in Montana. I was up there when they didn't have a speed limit up there. Everybody drove over 100 miles an hour because they could, because, you know, it was just voluntary. Safe and prudent up there, and so, you know, and they just found out that it just got too dangerous. You have to enforce things. You know, we can say, hey, don't beat the windows out of a buildings and rob them at night and just make it voluntary. No, you have to enforce things to get them done. And you guys that think we don't need the government involved in your cattle business, how'd those CFAP checks feel in your checking account? I'm sure you cashed them, right? You cashed them, and so that was the government interfering in your cattle business, wasn't it? But it probably saved your ass. So, you know, people like those CFAP bills. Well, there's no difference here. We need help making a level trading field here, playing field, trading business. We need some fair markets out there. We got to have a little competition. We need some market transparency. We got to get these things done. If we don't, we are done, guys. We're absolutely done. And I can't stress that to you anymore. We've got to have more competition in here. You've seen what they've done to our fat cattle market. We still got competition in our feeder cattle market and our calf markets, but for how long? For how long can they do that? Let's talk about your board on Wednesday. October live cattle futures down 22 cents at 121.77. December down 45 on Wednesday at 127.05. Your back months were mixed from down 50 cents to up 10, but no big major swings. September feeder cattle, of course, they're lining right up with what you're seeing me cash feeder cattle index is down 12 at 154.27. October was down a buck and a half. All your other back months of feeder cattle were down pretty hard because corn was up some. But October down 150 at 154.62. Your back months on feeder cattle down 80 to down a buck 77. Like I said, December corn was up 6.5 cents. On Wednesday at 539, it's pushing up there close to that 550. We assumed that we would trade somewhere between $5 and $5.50 a bushel during harvest, but they're pushing those top levels a little bit. Fat cattle trade was brisk. I'm gonna say that. It was brisk negotiated on Wednesday. It was the most active trading that we've seen for quite a while. Why is that? These packers need cattle. They haven't been buying many cattle out front for the 2 to 4 week delivery the last couple of weeks. They need some cattle. Historically, this is the time for them to make hay on their export sales. Now, not necessarily the deliveries, but the sales, but they've got to get some product in there. At the same time, they're backing off slaughter a little bit, but they're managing their supplies. But they come out and fairly briskly bought cattle in a negotiated manner, and it's the most active day that we've seen for quite some time on Wednesday. Iowa had negotiated cash sales of 11,000 head on Wednesday. That's huge for them this day and time. Live price steers and heifers 121 to 123.50. That's kind of on the weak side. Dress sales 192 to 196. Nebraska had 15,300 head of negotiated cash sales on Wednesday. That is impressive. 122 to 124 on a live basis. 188, which there was only one deal of that. That 188 was way off there. It was mostly 192 to 196. But Kansas had 6,000 head from 121 to 124 and a few dress sales at 196. But Kansas had 6,000 head of negotiated cash sales, and then also on Wednesday they turned in 15,700 head of negotiated grid. Okay, the negotiated grid base price was more narrow than the 121 to 124. It only had a $1 spread in it from 123 to 124. There's no negotiation in that negotiated grid. They're turning it in, trying to make it look like they got more negotiation going on, and there's no negotiation on there. You either take it or leave it. Texas, 6,200 head of cash sales on Wednesday. Negotiated grid sales turned in 7,600 head. All one price, mind you. There was a lot of negotiation going on in there, But your cash negotiation from 122 to 124. I have to give Consolidated Beef Producers credit this week. Even though they had a small pool, the Texas cash pool, less than 300 head, but at least they're trying. And then they asked for sealed bids, and they got those sales, those few heads sold at 124. I don't think we would have got 124 in the Southern Plains this week if they hadn't have done that. So give credit to them for that. You guys could participate in that if you would like to, or you could just live off of it, which most of you will do. We had fat cattle sales in Sioux Falls Regional Livestock Worthing, South Dakota in an auction on Wednesday. Your market was steady to $4 higher. Your fat cattle sold for the most part between 117 and 121.50 through the ring, with a few program fat cattle up to 123. Box beef cutout values, I told you they're continued lower. Your packers are slowing kill to stop that and level off on the supply, or at least pretend to their customers that they're having a shorter harvest, so they'll come to their milk and start buying a little more, and they'll quit having to dip those prices down. But we fell under $3 for the first time in quite a while. Choice cuts were down 423 at 297.33. Selects down 257 at 271.78. Your slaughter, and I told you we had one major that was dark on Wednesday. We got another one talking about cooler cleaning, another one talking about at least one shift cooler cleaning. But you know, it's funny, you know, making $1,000 ahead and you're slowing things down, they're going to get them anyway, guys. They're just so content to sit back and they can just handle everything. How about slaughter this week so far through Wednesday? 352,000. That's 11,000 less than last week, 4,000 less than the same week a year ago, and they're already saying that this week's total is going to be very disappointing. We've got what else is going on? Coming up on Friday, going to be another big run for Justin Tupper at St. Ange Livestock out in St. Ange, South Dakota. Going to have 700 yearlings on hand, 7,000 calves, be a lot of those light peewee calves that we've talked about here for the last several weeks. Guys can get an order in on there and buy some of those ranch-raised light peewee calves there. And some of them are starting to get up into middleweights now, of course, too. And then Saturday, got 2,000 cows, mostly way up, so be some bred cows in there. But as dry as it is, they probably won't bring enough to outpace your packers. So we are dwindling on supplies for that very reason up there in the dry region. But let's talk about your feeder cattle markets on Wednesday. Real-time index on DV Auction late in the day on Wednesday at 150.63. That's down 161, down pretty hard. It wasn't that our markets were that much lower this Wednesday, but we lost that Bassett special from last week. So when we lose those numbers, it's a seven-day moving average. Those drop off. No more big cattle we've been running the last week or so. It makes a difference when you lose that. They drop off quite a bit. Big sales on Wednesday. OKC West, El Reno, Oklahoma, 5,700 head. Feeder steers were $2 to $3 higher, even with the board down pretty good. Feeder heifers were $2 to $4 higher. Your calves steadied to $2 higher in a light test. Winter Livestock, Dodge City, Kansas, 1,800 head there. Steadied to $2 higher on your feeder cattle. Stick out deal in Dodge City, 62 head, 881 pound steers, bring $159.50. Market we've never talked about before. We're getting information on through Cattle Market Central. Buffalo Livestock Auction in Buffalo, Wyoming, sold 100 head, 459 pound steers at $185. We talk about Stockman's and Yankton on their fat cattle sale. They have good feeder cattle sales too. Stockman's Livestock Market, Yankton, South Dakota, on Wednesday, sold 111 big feeding steers. They weighed 966 and 153 and a quarter. That's higher than your index levels for an 800 pounder weighing nearly a grand there, guys. But the best quote that I saw anywhere on Wednesday, your Zach Tran top quote for the day, come out of Torrington Livestock Markets, Torrington, Wyoming, 69 head, 833 pound steers, bring $164. And that's your feeder flash for Thursday.